three cocktails by the time you read. Thank you so much. It's a great reading. I've really enjoyed listening to everyone so far, and it's hard to follow all this really beautiful rhythmic poetry with a clunky and dense piece of prose, so I apologize ahead of time.
I love the dense.
I'm going to read from something that comes about two-thirds of the way into the novel, so I've got to briefly catch you up on, you know, just 200 pages. Basically, this young woman has gone to Japan to teach English. She was placed by the government in a very small nuclear power plant town. She went in a sort of closeted relationship with her girlfriend, and they were living in this house, hadn't told anyone the circumstances of their relationship when they got there. And that relationship kind of combusted when they got to this small town and were living under these circumstances, and she had a little fling with her supervisor. It's kind of all you need to know at this point. Oh, the school is split. It's a technical school. Half of the school is secretarial classes where it's all girls, and the other half is technical classes that are all boys. And this is spring, and she's just started to have to teach these all-boys classes in this very small nuclear power plant town. Okay, I think that catches you up. As usual, the senior technical boys are practically naked when we enter their classroom this afternoon. Often at the start of the period, we find a few boys still changing out of their red nuclear power plant jumpsuits and into their school uniforms. But today, all 30 are wearing nothing but saggy boxers or dingy briefs. It's a rainy April day, and their skin is puckered with goose flesh, nipples hard and pursed. They sit at their desks in a parody of model pupils, smirking. "Please get ready for English class," Miyoshi-sensei says, his voice shaky. He spins around to write the target sentence on the board, but he can't hide the blush staining the backs of his ears or steady the tremble in his handwriting. The factory foreman gets around, by car, on foot, in an airplane. Once his back is turned, the boys resume doing whatever they were doing before we arrived, texting each other on their cell phones, playing video games, leafing through catalogs of sports cars, hairstyle magazines, and pornographic comic books. The comic book splayed in front of a kid named Nakajima shows a naked woman dangling from a meat hook, her legs spread and cuffed, about to be penetrated by an advancing subway car. "Mazuya," I say, "that's disgusting." I grab the book and clap it shut, but the boy just opens it again, calmly flipping the page. Nakajima is the senior class ringleader. While the other boys' bodies are awkward works in progress, still puffy with baby fat or gawky, stretched out but not yet filled in, he alone looks finished, hard. He has no excess flesh, but oddly, he's the reigning high school sumo champion, Ishikawa. He looks like the figure on the gold trophy he won in last year's competition, the lone trophy in the lobby display case. His skin tinted an orangey shade of brown from tanning lotion. Nakajima is also the reigning class ganguro, or blackface, with a perm the size of a football helmet and a gold medallion that nestles between his pecs, spelling out his blackface name in zirconium-studded pyrite, MC Nakaji. His older classmates like to copy him, especially his habit of lingering in his underwear to delay class. I'm sure today's prank was his idea. "Please put on your uniforms," Miyoshi-sensei says. "There's a woman here, nay?" "We can't," says a bulky kid named Sumio, one of Nakajima's minions, who has band-aids covering his crusty nipple piercings. "Why can't you?" Miyoshi-sensei asks. "Kieta," says Nakajima, without looking up from his comic book. "They vanished." Lots of things have been vanishing ever since Miyoshi-sensei and I started teaching the senior technical boys in February. The boys aren't supposed to be coming to the high school anymore at all. After taking their exams, they were scheduled to spend the last 2 months before graduation putting their technical training to use at Shika's nuclear power station. Then the prefectural exams were scored, and the scores averaged for each class. In English, Shika's technical class averaged 4%, an all-time low for Ishikawa, according to the front page headlines of the local paper. In her article, the reporter happened to mention that the senior technical boys were the only students at Shika High School never to have studied English with a native speaker. They alone had no idea how fun and useful English could be. Those were the same words the principal used when he summoned Miyoshi-sensei and me into his office. Parents had been calling, and he had to placate them. So up until graduation, the boys would be returning from the plant every day after lunch for a special English class with the two of us. We could teach them whatever we wanted, but our lessons had to be fun and useful. Miyoshi-sensei looked pale as he translated in the hallway. "I thought I was through with them," he said. "I have no fun or useful ideas. What will I do?" His dread was palpable, but I was almost glad for it. I sensed a distance between us. He was perfectly polite, but that was the problem. This was the first time we'd spoken candidly in months. I told him not to worry, that I would bring in all the fun worksheets and games I'd made for our other classes. These boys are wild animals, he scoffed. Would you expect a tiger to fill in some worksheet? A gorilla to perform your skit? I laughed and he groaned. I wish they were tigers, he said. Tigers can jump through hoops. Gorillas can sign. No, these boys were like fish, cold and slippery, impossible to hook. Did your uniforms really disappear? He asked the boy in Japanese. Obviously, Nakajima snaps at him. Then why don't you put your plant uniform back on, he suggests. No way, the boy says. It's soaking wet. Please, Miyoshi-sensei says. There's a woman here. Hazukashi desu. If Miss Marina is so shy, Nakajima says, then why does she always stare at us? Miyoshi-sensei glances at me and bites his lip. If I refuse to look away when the boys are changing, it's only because I don't want them to think they can intimidate me as easily as they intimidated their last female teacher. I wait for him to come to my defense. She's always staring at us, the boy continues. It's perverted. Make her turn around, then we'll do her stupid English lesson. His friends laugh, and Miyoshi-sensei clears his throat. Miss Marina, he hesitates. Maybe, do you think, could you please turn to look at the board? Are you serious? I say, feeling my own face heat up. My own hands begin to shake. I think Nakajima feels kind of shy to have his uniform off in front of a woman. Really, I say? Then why doesn't he put it back on? Kita, he replies, it vanished. Why do you let them get away with it, I say. Get away with it, he repeats. We let them walk all over us. I'm not the one who gets embarrassed every time they show a little skin. Who cares if they're undressed? I'm sorry, he said. You are kind of frantic. I can't catch much of this English. Why don't you read today's target sentences? Then you will appear to have some purpose here. I spin around, crossing my arms. The boys hate to be made examples of, so I insert Nakajima's name into the target sentence. Nakajima gets around, I bellow, by bus, on foot, in a plane. Moichido, Miyoshi-sensei says, one more time. Nakajima gets around, I yell, so loud that my words echo off the portable classroom walls. When I start to laugh, Miyoshi-sensei asks me what's so funny. In Japan, it's considered rude to have a private joke. Someone might think you were laughing at him. I explain that gets around means sleeps around. It means he is sleepy. It means he has sex, a lot of sex with a lot of different people. Ah, he says, an American joke. I should share with the class, eh? To my surprise, the boys actually laugh, all except for Nakajima, who is scowling at his cell phone, studying the screen as it registers an incoming call, the ringtone, a digital rendition of Roberta Flack's Killing Me Softly. Nakajima sleeps around, I yell even louder. Nakajima sleeps around, Miyoshi-sensei alone repeats after me. Shut up, homo, the boy mutters. What did you say, I asked, leaning over his desk. We're close enough that I can see the dandruff salting his big perm, the blackhead studying his nostrils, the sleep encrusted in the corners of his eyes. Shut up, homo, he repeats, maddeningly calm. When I raise my hand, he doesn't duck, doesn't raise his own hand, or call out to Miyoshi-sensei, who has his back to me now as he erases the sentence on the board. He just looks right at me, his eyes like two black holes, daring me to go ahead and hit him, knowing that I won't. I'm not that brave or that dumb. I'm not going to hit a student, but I can't do nothing either. To do nothing would be like going into a bank, waving a gun around, and then making a withdrawal from an ATM machine. On his desk, his cell phone starts to ring again. I grab it and drop it into my pocket. Thanks.